Sorry, friends, I was praying in the back, and then I got stuck talking. Aren't you shocked by that? Yeah, yeah. Well, welcome. I'm Marie Smith, and I'm the pastor here at Community United Methodist Church, and I am so glad to be worshiping here with you this morning. We have lots of things. Today's the fourth week of Advent, and we draw closer to Christmas. I think this is this year is the in our seasons of in the church year. This is the latest that Christmas can be, so we get the longest time to wait and prepare for Christmas Eve and Christmas Day this season. So we have a whole nother week to wait, right? That we're waiting for Christmas Eve, and so. This week, we are excited for our children to bring us some joy this morning as they sing. Our children's ministry has been working diligently for weeks now. They've been having the children sing and practice. At least my son, who told me he's been kind of moving between, "I'm not singing," to belting it out in the shower. So if he hides, we'll know why. We'll see. We'll see. He's already, pilfered through the cookies on the cookie table out there. So we'll see how this all goes. So this morning, we are, I would say we would welcome the people on Facebook, except that we have no internet. And we haven't for a week. It's been super exciting, wherever Melissa is, isn't it? Yeah, yeah, it's been super exciting. And so we're just going to go with it, and we'll see how it all goes. We're still working on it. So for those of you who got the communicator, we did that a little late because that's just how that worked. We're working it. We're trying our best. A little extra prayer for internet here at our church. Yes, as Patty says, please say because everything we do, 20 years ago, we were not so dependent on such things, but today we are a little more dependent on it. There's a couple things that I want to share with you about the life of the church. If you would take a few minutes, fill out those pew pads and send them down the rows. That's our connection to you. The second thing I'd like to share with you is just some things that are coming up. So we delivered, some of us delivered our angels packages and boxes and all of those things. I got to do that yesterday, and as I was delivering, the family that I delivered to said, oh my gosh, and that too, and that too, and that too. They were overwhelmed with the generosity. And so if you haven't picked up your angel, if you weren't able to do that yesterday, would you see Melissa? She'll be in the Welcome Center here after church. I think she has on a black shirt. All black today. All black today. So she'll be over here next to the on the other side of the cookies, over towards the office area. She'll be able to help you figure that out. Or you can call the office to try to arrange how to get your to deliver to your angels. Also, remember Christmas Eve, we have a luncheon that's from noon to 2. We're going to have ham and dessert and all the trimmings to a Christmas dinner if you'd like to have that. My family ate that last year, and it was delicious. So if you'd like to have that, if you're busy and you're in between and you need that, we would love for you to join us for that Christmas Eve lunch from noon to 2. Everyone is welcome. If you know someone, please let us know. We would love for you to join us for that. In your bulletin, again, you have a postcard for you to hand to somebody. It's for you to give to somebody and say, hey, I would love for you to come to worship. I'd love for you to come and join me for Christmas Eve services. For you to say, hey, come and join. This is what we're doing for Christmas. And it's just simply to say, where are you going to go to church on Christmas Eve? And so it's a way to invite somebody. Remember, it's the time when we get to share the light of Jesus with people. And so we want to make sure that you do that. If you bake cookies or would like to help with hosting Christmas Eve at 5 or 7, we still need your Christmas cookies. There's some information in the bulletin about that. Well, friends, let's continue in worship this morning as we sing together our opening song, Hail the Lord's Anointed. It'll be on the screen on page 203 in your hymnal, verses 1, 3, and 4. Won't you stand?
Seated.
Good morning. Okay.
Well, we have one more week till Christmas. Are you guys ready?
Yes, we're ready to be out of school, out of work for a few days. So yes, we are ready, but we still have some last minute details to do before the big day.
Do you think Mary and Joseph had some last minute details to do before their big day?
I would imagine that they did, Harper. They would have been getting ready to leave for Bethlehem. They would have been packing, getting all of those last minute details completed. Think about it. They would have been putting together the blankets and other baby things for Jesus. I wonder if they had to restart their journey like we sometimes forget something and have to go back to the house for it, don't we?
Yes.
All right.
Those are details. They just don't tell us in the Bible.
As we light this last Advent candle, we are reminded of the last minute details and how Jesus is always in those details, no matter the size. All right, let us pray. Holy and illuminating God, grant us patience as we await your coming. Remind us of your steadfast love and grace in our lives. Amen.
Now, won't you stand as you're able and turn and welcome one another to worship today.
Hey, Alice. And now we're going to invite the children to come and share with us some songs they've been working on. And so I'm going to invite the kids to come on down. All right.
If you want to read that right there, that would be perfect.
First paragraph, like the whole
whatever you want. You can have, pass it to her next if you want to do one paragraph. Come on, Mikey, come over here. Okay, go ahead.
And there were in the same country shepherds abiding in the field. Keep watch over the flock at night, by night. And lo, the angel of the Lord came upon them, and the glory of the Lord shone round about them. And they were sore afraid.
We can just like do like all the paragraph.
You want to do one?
And the angel said unto them, Fear not, for behold, I bring you good tidings of great joy, which shall be to all people. For unto you is born this day in the city of David a Savior, which is Christ the Lord. And this shall be a sign unto you, ye shall find the baby wrapped in swaddling cloths, lying in a manger.
After everybody, we're going to sing. Okay, one, do one. Come here, Mikey. Come here, I'll hold you. Come here. Go ahead.
And suddenly it came to pass the angels were gone away from them into heaven. The shepherds said to one another, Let us now go to unto Bethlehem and see this thing which is come to pass, which is the Lord hath made known unto us. And they came with haste and found Mary, Joseph, and the baby, and the babe laying in the manger.
Okay, we're ready.
I'm going to do it.
You did do it. Now everybody's going to sing, okay?
You did it.
Good job.
To heaven to live with thee there.
great company of the heavenly hosts appeared with the angel, praising God and saying, "Glory to God in the highest, and peace on earth, and goodwill toward men." A star of wonder glowed brightly above. With the promise of peace and the gift of God's love, heaven's joy rang out around the earth, bringing the glad tidings of our dear Savior's birth. May peace be your gift this Christmas.
Thanks for watching, and remember, Jesus is the reason for the season.
Special thanks to all of the Sunday school teachers who have worked diligently on this. They have practiced with these kids. They can't hear us. They are long gone. They have worked diligently on this. So, and they're going to do this again at 10:30. And so the kids have worked. They have put them in costume. They have practiced with them. They have worked really hard. It's been a dream of theirs that they be able to sing in church last year they asked the same question. And so I know that they have been dreaming about this. And so just when you see them in the hall, when you're getting donuts with them, would you just say, give them a word of congratulations, because they have done a really good job to pull this off. And so I'm really proud of them because, at any given moment, you see all of these children up here, but at any given moment, they don't have all of them, right? There's at any given moment, they have, they have these five kids, and then they have these six kids, and then they have these, and so they have done a remarkable job of being able to really love on children. When I was thinking about I'm doing a little advertisement. I was thinking about the people who have said to me from day one, "Hey, how do we grow? Because we really want to reach kids in a whole new way." It's been this group of people. They love kids. They want they want to share the love of Jesus with people. They have been doing this. They've taught you, right? Some of you they've taught. And so they have a burning desire to reach people who have yet to come. It's their greatest desire in the world to do that. And they will do it through cupcakes and birthday parties for Jesus, and they will do it through crafts, they will do it through singing, they will do it through any way possible. Those people who you saw help teach children. That's what they love to do. So I just want to say thank you to all of them. So if you have a chance, you should just make sure that you also just reach out to them. Well, friends, let's turn to God in prayer. I've lost my notes. I got just, flustered with them. This morning, we have, I want to remind you of some of the people that we want to just continue. They are on your prayer list. We want to keep Abby Shear and her family in our prayers. She had her baby. As some of you know, Abby Shear had a baby that has a heart defect, and it's a pretty rare one. Her baby, she was born 8 pounds and something, so it's a pretty healthy. I saw pictures of her. She's got a little smushy face, so she's so cute and snuggly. They immediately, within about an hour of her giving birth, moved her by ambulance to the Nationwide Children's, where she is at the moment, and she will have her first surgery, one of three that she'll have within the first 2 years of her life. So she'll have that next surgery within 5 days. So if we can keep Abby and TC in our prayers, their whole family. Abby gave me permission to share all of this with you. The more prayers, the better. And so Abby was able to be released. She had the baby on Friday, and she was able to go Saturday morning over. As soon as rounds were over, they released her to be able to go and be with the baby. So I'm not allowed to tell you what the baby's name is yet. That I wasn't given permission. So if you all know it, you can share it amongst yourselves. I'm not telling that. However, I'm hoping to go up. They get 6 people in the hospital. I'm not one of those 6. I'm going to put my clergy collar on and go up and see this baby. From the wind, I'm going to see it from the, I'm not going to hold this baby, but keep, the defect that this baby has 5 years ago, she would have died. And today, because of miracles, she's not. And so it is truly a gift. So we want to make sure that we want to pray for this family and for Abby, for the other kids, everyone involved. So I want to make sure that we highlight Abby and her family. Friends, in front of you, there are some prayer cards. If you want to take a few minutes, fill those out, put them in the plate as they pass you by so that we might continue in prayer that way. Let us prepare our hearts as we sing together hymn number 221, verse 1, In the Bleak Midwinter Time.
How about...
And let us pray. O God of grace and God of mercy, as we draw closer towards Christmas, the hurriedness of the season envelops us. It is easy to get caught up in the more. Doing more, feeling the rush feeling the pressure and yet we are called, we long for the simplicity of the manger, the rustic nature of the stable calls our name. You remind us, O God, that love did come down at Christmas. And so as we wrap up these last minute details, let us not forget to keep you at the center. Forgive us when we are angry and short-tempered, when we are frustrated with one another, when we go on too little sleep and too much anxiety. Let our hearts long for your peace, a peace that we find on Christmas morn, that the angels sang of and the shepherds kneeled. Let our hearts be settled into. Lord, we pray that we might share that peace with others. In this world that feels chaotic, we pray for those that are on our prayer list, those that feel lost and lonely, that are ill, that have lost loved ones. We ask for your mercy and grace. We ask you, O God, that they might find peace. The peace of Christmas. And we pray all of this in the name of Jesus, who taught us to pray together with one voice. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen. And now, friends, it's the time when we offer back to God a portion of what God's given to us. And so I invite you to give God your very best. I invite the ushers to come forward.
Won't you stand for the doxology on page 95 of the hymnal?
Praise God from whom all
and gracious God, we offer these, our tithes and offering, back to you. We ask, Lord, that you would use these gifts to expand your kingdom here on earth, we pray. Amen.
Good morning. I am not Sue McGuire. Our scripture reading this morning comes to us from the book of Luke, chapter 19, verses 1 through 10. Hear these words. Then Jesus entered and passed through Jericho. Now behold, there was a man named Zacchaeus, who was a chief tax collector, and he was rich. And he sought to see Jesus, who Jesus was, but could not because of the crowd, for he was of short stature. So he ran ahead and climbed up into a sycamore tree to see him, for he was going to pass that way. And when Jesus came to that place, he looked up and saw him and said to him, Zacchaeus, make haste and come down, for today I am to stay at your house. So he made haste and came down and received him joyfully. But when they saw it, they all complained, saying, he has gone to be a guest with a man who is a sinner. Then Zacchaeus stood and said to the Lord, look, Lord, I give half of my goods to the poor, and if I have taken anything from anyone by false accusation, I restore fourfold. And Jesus said to him, today salvation has come to this house, because he is also a son of Abraham. For the Son of Man has come to seek and to save that which was lost.
Let us pray. Holy and gracious God, open our hearts so that we might hear what you need us to hear. Lord, do this through me or in spite of me, but in every case, hide me behind your cross. Amen. So this season, we've been talking about Christmas decorations. We've talked about all kinds of ways in which we decorate. And so the question is, how many of you are completely ready for Christmas? Like, everything is done. Any of you completely ready? One person. Really? One person. Two people. Three people. Four people. I feel like we got like a few of you. Okay. We're getting a few more. There's not a test for this, I promise. Like, you know, when I say ready, I mean like your presents are wrapped, your cards, if you send out Christmas cards, are sent, your food is bought, and maybe even prepped, the lists are made, and maybe even checked off. Yes, Alice, I'm talking about you. Yeah. We have like a running joke. Plural list, right. She has multiple lists for multiple things. Well, I just say congratulations. You should just teach the rest of us how to do that, because, wow. I think I told you all this last year, but on December 19th, I don't know what it is about that day, but something happens on that day, and that's the day that I usually flip out. So watch out tomorrow. It's like that 6 days before Christmas, I feel like the last minute details are going to just derail me. I don't know. It's like this perfect universe where I have made all these wonderful plans on December 1st, where I think, that's it. I even have like Pinterest pages full of like teacher gifts and leader gifts that I'm going to make, you know? Wouldn't these be wonderful ideas? Actually, I start before December. I think, oh, I'm just going to make these wonderful things for people. And that all gets thrown out the window, and I have to go to Kroger on my way to the party, right? Yeah, yep. And I always, you know, forget at least three things, so I have to add extra gift cards. And I always want to wrap beautiful gift, you know, boxes and wrap things and put beautiful bows on them. And it And I always like end up with like things in bags and sometimes even in plastic bags. Like, here you go. Surprise. Now, I am not alone in this. I have some fellow clergy friends and I lament this mad dash. One of my churches, we even had a folk story of the brown bag Christmas. We added to it each year, like we added like an old, you know, fish tale. We talked about how that eventually, this started out a real story, but about how that their children, this clergy person, my friend, essentially on Christmas Eve, they were like, I don't have anything done. What are we going to do? And so they came up with this idea. Everything went in a brown Kroger bag, stapled on top. And some of them got ribbons or bows. Brown paper bag Christmas. And so now it's become kind of this like folklore kind of thing. Well, you know what? You can just have a brown paper bag Christmas. That's all it is, just brown paper bag Christmas. Now, the funny thing is, if you go back and talk to my clergy friend, she would tell you that that brown paper bag Christmas was the most memorable and best. Because sometimes the last minute details can create lasting details, that lasting memories that transform us, can't they? Now, my clergy friend, she learned to scale back and change some of the ways that she did church and honestly her life. This morning, we're going to talk about the last minute details, the things that sort of we do on the fly, or the things that we sort of think about that we do on the fly that make a lasting difference. I think about Mary and Joseph. About this time, they were on their way, right? Or packing to get on their way. It took about a week to get there. Think about the things they were packing. Well, should we take this thing or not this thing? How much time will you need to rest? Joseph might have been telling her. Things that we do on the fly that make a lasting difference to our faith. Jesus is doing just this thing in this morning's scripture. He's headed to Jerusalem. He knows what awaits him there. It's the end of his ministry. And Zacchaeus is the last person that he will really interact with. Have that personal interaction with that. He will make a lasting impact on Zacchaeus. And so Jesus is doing what we're doing this week. He's wrapping up loose ends. And on his way, a crowd has gathered in Jericho. His disciples, the followers who've been with him for 3 weeks, they have watched him do all of ministry, right? Perform miracles, walk on water. They've eaten with him. They've done all of the things that you do. Now, some that are following him, it wasn't just the 12. There are people that kind of followed him along the way. They've watched him be criticized by the religious folks. They've seen the way that people reacted to him. And so as he walks into Jericho, he's surrounded by this group of people. The crowd, they're excited by him. They think, what's he going to do next, right? And the people there, they all wanted something different from him. Some wanted him to charge into Jerusalem and take back the city. They wanted him to be like King David. Others wanted him to just go away, stop creating chaos in Jericho. Just keep going. No more ruckus here. Some wanted them to heal them. The truth is, we all want something different from Jesus this Christmas, don't we? We all need something different. Some of us want him to take away our worries and anxiety. We live on the edge, filled with fear. It's just the way it is. If I think about all the last minute details, when we think about those, we just, it's like a big ball of angst. And so some of us want Jesus to just give us some relief. Some of us have experienced pain and heartache. And so we want comfort. We've lost loved ones. We've gotten news from the doctor that we didn't expect. It's just been hard. And so this Christmas season has been filled with brokenness. And so we want comfort. For others, we want the desire of our hearts. Just ask any of these little children that were up here. That's what they want, right? Our lives perhaps have been easy and comfortable, little pain, the normal ups and downs of life. And so as we approach Christmas, we want the awe and wonder. We want everything that Christmas promises in every secular Christmas song. And so we are a lot like that crowd in Jericho, pulling Jesus in lots of directions. And so then he sees Zacchaeus and he's like, hey, you! He knows that Zacchaeus is different. Now Zacchaeus, he's a powerful guy in the Jewish community. He's a chief tax collector. Did you pick up that? That means he's in charge. Here's the thing. Zacchaeus was drawn to Jesus too. Just like us, we too are drawn to Jesus, but for different reasons, right? Jesus, I mean, I know he's not literally walking through our town on the way to Columbus, but we're still drawn to him this Christmas. It's why we're here. Now, we know Zacchaeus' story. He climbs into a tree. We know you're singing the story in your head, right? Zacchaeus was a wee little man, and a wee little man is he. That's what you were singing when you heard that, right? But what's interesting about this story is that Zacchaeus doesn't give any excuses as to why he can't see Jesus. He just acts. He just does it. He climbs up in a tree. And Jesus senses this. And he says, you know what, Zacchaeus, I'm going to go to dinner at your house tonight. I'm coming to dinner. We get so distracted by the last minute details that we forget about the main event. Zacchaeus wasn't. He didn't get distracted. He didn't let the excuses. He could have said, it's not worth it. I can't see anything. I'm just going to go home. No, he was drawn to Jesus. And so he said, I'm going to go. I'm going to do this. And so what excuses do we give? It's easy, right, to give excuses. I don't have time to read my Bible. I fall asleep. Where do I even start? The thing is, we don't fall asleep watching football. At least I don't. I can't serve the poor. I don't have time for that. You should see my calendar. It is full. But we can go to dinner with our friends twice a week. Oh, get off my toes. That is for me. I'm just saying. Wait, what excuses are we using? For Zacchaeus, he doesn't use excuses. He climbs a tree. When was the last time you climbed a tree? I mean, I don't know that I would climb a tree to see even my favorite people. Like, I like football and all, but I'm not sure that I would climb a tree to see Andy Dalton or Joe Burrow. Would you? I mean, really? I mean, it's a little undignified, isn't it? It would create a scene. But that's exactly what Zacchaeus does. And what kind of reception does Zacchaeus get? Jesus says, I'm going to your house. Here's the thing. Jesus' encounter on the road was one thing, but it was just the beginning. When he gets to his house, Zacchaeus continues to be changed by Jesus. It wasn't just this chance encounter. When Jesus shows up, Zacchaeus is radically changed by this relationship with Jesus. And in Luke 19:8, it says, Zacchaeus stood there and said to the Lord, look, half of my possessions, Lord, I will give to the poor. And if I have defrauded anyone of anything, I will pay it back four times as much. This wasn't just an encounter on the street. It wasn't just about Jesus' reputation. It was about a transformation This was about a relationship that Jesus built with Zacchaeus. It was about spending time, breaking bread, having conversation. Now, to think, Jesus could have just kept going, gone right through Jericho, and he could have missed this relationship with Zacchaeus, but he didn't. Instead, he built a relationship with this man, with someone who didn't use an excuse, who was willing to be open and ready for change, who was willing to admit his mistakes and right his wrongs. Because that's what he does in that scripture. He says, if I was wrong, I'll make it right. Here's the truth. We all make excuses. Just recently, I made a whole list of the reasons why I couldn't do something instead of why I could. We all close ourselves off from change because the truth is, change is easy to say somebody else should do it, right? Oh, we can see change for others, but it's hard to happen for us. And admitting our mistakes and moving on, that's the Christian way. It's the way of the cross. It's what we do. It's what sets us apart from other religions. Jesus died for us, and at Christmas, we often get hung up on all the other things that we ought to be doing. And we forget to give ourselves some grace, to forgive, and to move on. And so here is your Advent challenge. Oh, goodness, look at the time. Here's your Advent challenge. First, I just want to just challenge you to, how can you get untangled from the last minute details? What can you set aside? Do you have to do it all? Right? I decided this year we were going to do grilled cheese and tomato soup at least twice this week. Because who cares? 1 week of not having vegetables, it didn't matter. Was not going to kill us. Right? I mean, it really wasn't. Who are the nurses? And it doesn't matter, does it? Will it really matter, Becky? It won't matter, will it? Thank you. See, she's my resident nurse. Won't matter. I mean, it really won't. Not for a week. What can you untangle and let go of? What are you getting hung up so that you can't see the gift of the manger? Can you sit with Jesus sometime this week, allowing him to nurture and comfort you? That's what he did to Zacchaeus, right? He went and had a relationship with him at his house. He ate dinner with him. When are you having that relationship? And then pray about who you can invite to worship Christmas Eve or Christmas Day. Maybe your life is too busy on Christmas Eve and you need to come back Christmas Day. Again, it's going to be super relaxed. I mean, really relaxed and shortened. How can you make room for Jesus Christmas Eve or Christmas Day? Well, let us pray. Good and gracious God, we give you thanks for today. We ask that you would move and have your way with us. Help us to untangle these last minute details. Let us see you in the midst of them. And help us to expand our faith because of them. We ask all this in the name of Jesus. Amen. Well, friends, let's stand and sing our closing song. I don't know how many verses we have of it.
Three.
Can we sing two?
Verse two, sure.
Let's sing two.
Lift up your heads, ye mighty gates. Page 213, or it will be on screen.
thought we were going to have a little fire there. Church on fire. It's all good. My whole life I was an acolyte. I can only imagine. And we had to sit up front, so I can't imagine what that was like. Friends, I invite you to go out from this place and know that Jesus goes with us. Jesus gives us the promise and the hope of everlasting life, but also the peace that passes all understanding. Go and share this good news with everyone that you meet. Go in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Amen. Come have some cookies and donuts and all kinds of other yummy stuff. Have a seat so that you might hear the postlude. Go in peace.